Hi, and welcome to my talk, Runtime Factors in Software Engineering for Machine Learning. I'm not in attendance at Shonan, mostly due to the flights being canceled and the typhoons. My goals of attending Shonan was to discuss with the rest of you the multitude of machine learning solutions for various problems and the kind of engineering choices and trade-offs we would get there, as well as how machine learning is being adopted in various software fields, all the way from mobile to services to cloud to embedded. And each one of these fields or domains has different kinds of requirements, especially on things like performance. From there, I want to discuss about requirements, design, and runtime trade-offs, mostly about performance non-functional requirements, and requirements of ML. So why are you using ML? What do you seek out of it? Can you trade off certain kinds of evaluation performance with runtime performance? What kind of time or overhead can you account for? What resources are available? These should all come into play when one is deciding to use machine learning. So here's our motivational example. Your boss comes up, you're a developer, your boss comes up and says, our mobile app needs some machine learning. You say, okay, but I haven't deployed machine learning before. And you start thinking, well, which algorithm should we actually use for the machine learning? And then if we choose an algorithm, how do we know it's any good? What level of performance do we seek? And how are we going to measure that performance? But furthermore, what is like the energy consumption or the runtime performance that we're actually seeking? If it's on a mobile platform, energy performance matters a lot. If it's in the cloud, energy performance probably matters less, unless it is a big model that's being put onto GPU machines, and so the availability of GPU machines is a big deal. On mobile, you have customers who are concerned that you might brick their phone, kill their battery, or kill their data plan. They are facing limitations in terms of CPU use and memory use on the phone that leads to battery use, as well as energy consumption due to communication over a data plan. So if you're doing machine learning on video or on images, it's not very efficient for them to send all the images over to the cloud. It's quite bandwidth intensive, and that might cost an end user quite a bit. So we're really concerned about this. So we wrote a paper about it, and that paper is, what can Android mobile app developers do about the energy consumption of machine learning? This was mostly worked on by Andrea McIntosh, who now works for, I think, Google. And I was supervising her at the time. And then Safwat Hassan, who recently graduated from Queen's University from Ahmed Hassan's lab, he helped us determine the adoption of machine learning. So one of the first questions we had was, do mobile apps actually use machine learning? Like, should we be studying this? And so Safwat went out and downloaded tons and tons of apps. And then we searched what those apps use in terms of libraries. And we found ML library imports in popular apps. The uses of ML in the popular apps typically was regression, face recognition and computer vision, gestures and handwriting, some math-related use like a regression model, as well as straight-out classification. So we went through about 2,000 apps, and 4% of them used machine learning libraries. And this was 2016-2017. TensorFlow wasn't that popular. Only two apps out of the 2,000 actually used it. But there was a lot of like Apache Commons and OpenCV and gestures and other kinds of computer vision aspects. So we decided that we're going to come up with a benchmark. We're going to use a variety of data sets and a variety of machine learners like Naive Bayes, Support Vector Machine, K-Nearest Neighbors, Random Forest, different implementations of them. And we're going to apply them in different classification tasks. So we're mostly focused on classification, both training a supervised classifier and evaluating a supervised classifier. This ranges from images to text to continuous measurement to demographics to signals. And what we did is we basically made a benchmark for a learner and a for a learner and a data set, and we ran each pair 10 times under two different treatments for crossfolds validation versus 50-50 splits. So we were recording the training and the testing, and we were measuring this using the green miner, which physically measures the phone's energy consumption. So what was interesting is that the different algorithms performed differently. They performed differently in terms of their evaluation performance. So in this case, we're talking about kappa or accuracy. And they also performed differently in terms of the amount of energy they used. And so due to these different two dimensions of performance, we could plot the solutions along a Pareto front. And this Pareto front meant that anything below it on the Pareto front is more efficient. But basically everything along this front is dominating. That means at this point, no one has as good of accuracy for as little energy consumption that this uses. So this is pretty accurate for that amount of energy consumption. Then we go here and we see there's no one here, there's no one there. And then finally we go up a little bit and we see this one. No one has better energy consumption for this amount of accuracy. This solution here uses more energy for the same performance, just like this solution here uses more energy for a similar amount of performance. These dominating ones are basically optimal in both energy and accuracy. So basically you get to choose which direction you want to go. Do you want to use less energy? Do you want to use more energy? And if you use more energy, you're getting more accuracy. If you're using less energy, typically you're getting less accuracy. So for training, that is, the cost of training and then the evaluation of training, what's the energy performance? So we train a classifier and we're looking at the training energy consumption versus the evaluation of the classifier. And we can see that a neural net such as MLP, a multi-layer perceptron, costs quite a bit. We also see something interesting, that a support vector machine is dominated by random forest logistic regression and multi-layer perceptron. Why? Well, it turns out that multi-layer perceptron is kind of linear in the amount of data. So it's big O is kind of linear in the amount of data, whereas support vector machines oftentimes are squared. K-nearest neighbors trains up really well because you can lazy train it. These other ones require differing amounts. Naive Bayes is mostly a storage issue. But when we go to evaluation, our efficient ones like Naive Bayes and KNN go away. When we're actually evaluating the classifier and we're running it lots of times, like say looking at different frames of video multiple times per second, the evaluation performance is different. MLP is somewhat efficient but also quite accurate. Logistic regression is pretty good. J48 is pretty good. If we just compare train versus test, we can see certain algorithms have higher costs for training versus testing. And k-nearest neighbors costs more to evaluate than it does to train because it's lazy training. Zero R does nothing. It just does a summary stat. And it doesn't cost much on either one, but it's not very accurate. Whereas MLP costs quite a bit to train, but costs very little to evaluate. Pretty well similar to a support vector machine. Effectively, we correlated all these algorithms against and fit their big O to their performance of those algorithms, and we were basically finding a 0.8 to 1.0 correlation between a best fit big O model and energy consumptions. Effectively, this means that if you're not I/O heavy and you know you're just CPU and memory bound, that your runtime big O is a reasonable estimate of the energy consumption of your classical ML algorithms. Thus, really what you're seeing is kind of, after the Pareto fronts were built, is we're really seeing a trade-off between energy and evaluation performance or accuracy. So developers actually have this choice. So what that study concluded was that machine learning was becoming more popular in the App Store, more and more apps were using it, that one could find the Pareto front of solutions of different learners for both training and testing. And the set that were more efficient for training is different than the set that was for testing. And we found fundamentally that developers have a trade-off to make between accuracy and energy. So if they don't care about energy, they can just go and use a big neural network and get good accuracy. But if they have an energy or runtime overhead or a latency overhead, they have different choices. So you can download the paper here. But that's not all. That was a while ago. That's 2017. The world moves on, and so do other frameworks. So TensorFlow came out around that time, especially for mobile. And we tried it out, three-layered, multi-layer perceptron. And you can see here, it uses quite a bit of energy when it's running. It's pretty expensive. And so we benchmarked it, and we showed in the same thing. And what we pretty well found out was, yeah, well, at least for the data sets we ran with it, a computer vision-oriented deep neural net, such as the Inception network, uses a ton of energy. Like, multiple orders of magnitude, three or more orders of magnitude more energy. Whereas a kind of simple MLP, which is only going to be three layers, but will have a lot of weights, typically did all right, but it was oftentimes dominated by simpler MLPs or random forests and things like that. So this was kind of a concern. Basically, the larger, more successful vision neural networks are very expensive. And really, it really pushes for the need for like an NPU or an MPU. So what I wanted to talk about at the Shonan was basically like there's oftentimes a trade-off. And this trade-off is oftentimes a evaluation performance versus a runtime trade-off or a runtime measure such as energy consumption, time, latency, anything like that. And the classical ML algorithms probably should not be ignored by developers, even if they have access to things like TensorFlow, because they are pretty energy efficient for what they do, and trade-offs can be had. So your trade-offs can actually be analyzed and decided upon at requirements, design time, and even runtime. Thus, probably what's needed is developers need something, like whether documentation or simulators or models or estimates, to help them address these trade-offs such that they can choose at design time, requirements time, or even runtime, which algorithms they should use in their current context. So there's a lot of software engineering just in terms of helping developers make choices about machine learning alone. Anyways, I appreciate you listening. Hope I kept this short enough, and hope to talk to you over the internet or in person in the future. Thank you.